Hello everyone, thanks for joining in. I'm going to use this platform to inquire from well-known economists, strategists, as well as policymakers to make sense of the world that we all live in, the lockdown world that is. And perhaps this will be useful in our investing decision, both for me as well as all of you. So today we have a star economist, a very popular one. Perhaps all of you know her already. So thank you, Sonal, for being here. I just need a confirmation that you can hear me.
Yes. Hi, Manish, and hi everyone. Great to be here.
So let's get talking. Sonal, the first and foremost thing in my mind, and for all the investors, is how do you make sense of this world from a growth standpoint? Cyclically. How, as an analyst economist, you're looking at the growth in India as well as, pretty much across the world. Can you place us vis-a-vis the pre-COVID world? I mean, I know that, you have these interesting indices, stuff like, I think the normalization index that you created, I do read all your reports, your business resumption index, and I think the leading indicator index that you have, could you sort of elaborate this for us, for the investors, as to what they are and, what are they hinting at?
Sure, Manish. I think, let's just focus on the cyclical view and while we are fighting COVID-19, because the world after we get a vaccine could be a bit different in terms of the impact on trend. So let me focus first on the cyclical view while we have COVID-19. And I think broadly, both for India as well as globally, we're basically seeing this as a three-stage process. So the first phase was back in March and April, where we saw the sudden stop in demand. Phase two has really been, May, June, onwards, where as lockdowns are relaxed, you've seen a pickup in growth, normalization in activity, pent-up demand, whatever one wants to call it. And phase three is going to be when most economies have normalized to whatever the normal level is for them, the new normal. And this new normal is going to really differ, across countries, depending on how well they've done on COVID-19 fight. The sequential pace of recovery is going to slow down. So in terms of where is India in this cycle, clearly we are right now in phase two, where with the lockdowns being relaxed, you are seeing across the board improvement in activity. At some point in time over the next, maybe it's 2 months, 3 months, we will transition into phase three, where there will be a sequential, slowdown in the pace of improvement in activity. But at this stage, there is an across the board improvement in the numbers. But what is interesting, though, is that it's a fairly uneven pace of recovery. So, the aggregate supply side indicators, things like, cement, steel, etc., have more or less normalized to, let's say, about 82% of their pre-pandemic normal. But if you look at the aggregate demand indicators, they're still lagging at between 65, slightly over 65% of their pre-pandemic normal. So clearly the demand side is still lagging the supply side pickup. You're seeing the services sector indicators, which tend to be more contact intensive, also lagging behind. So if you look at a lot of transportation segment indicators, they are still lagging. Rural, we know, is doing better than urban. So it's an across the board pickup. Huge divergence between, sectors, demand broadly behind supply. But we are in phase two, Manish. And I think as we look ahead, we should ensure that we do not linearly extrapolate from here. Because what we are seeing in India is, because we've opened up the economy while COVID-19 remains an issue, we are actually plateauing out in terms of a lot of high frequency indicators, significantly below pre-pandemic normal. So very soon, sequential improvement in activity will taper off till we get, let's say, a vaccine and things then, could improve. But there's obviously a big impact on medium-term trend, which of course we can discuss later.
But, you know, I want to understand, Sonal, on this, that, you know, what explains that, you know, our growth recovery sort of has stayed somewhat underwhelming, and especially, I think you also put together a report on North-South divide within Asia, but also vis-a-vis, you know, many other countries, the recovery in India has been patchy as well as tepid. What explains this? Is this the poor public policy response, you know, too severe a lockdown? What explains this? You know, why have we not recovered as fast as many other countries, including, you know, some developed countries like US have recovered?
So I think, first of all, actually, India had one of the most stringent lockdowns. So clearly the sudden stop and the collapse in activity was also quite severe. So in fact, Philippines has seen something very similar to India. So that's there. But I think you're right that, in fact, you know, as we look ahead, where every country is seeing normalization in activity, what we are seeing is that the pace of recovery is actually diverging across countries. And this divergence in turn is actually being driven by multiple factors. One is, of course, you know, whether a country has been able to contain COVID-19 or not. So if you're a Taiwan, where, of course, it was never a big issue to begin with, activity has, of course, normalized. But even in cities like city states like Singapore, which had a very severe lockdown back in April, May, June, COVID as of now is in check and activity is sort of normalizing back to normal. Whereas India, actually, you know, we would club it with countries like Philippines and Indonesia, where you're still fighting COVID-19 and you're normalizing at, you know, 70% below normal, 60, 80% below normal, depending on who you are. So the one reason for why you're seeing this big gap is the COVID control. Second is the tech cycle, because the one sector that has done very well other than pharmaceuticals is really the tech sector, because obviously you've seen this entire move towards digitization. And countries who are there in the tech value chain, whether it's a Korea or a Taiwan, clearly have benefited. But if you're exporting sort of regular products, there hasn't really been that kind of, you know, boost to demand. And third, as you were alluding to, is actually the policy stimulus. I mean, ultimately, this is COVID-19, this is a very big cash flow shock. And the biggest challenge still for policymakers is to ensure that this cash flow shock does not lead to any permanent damage. Permanent damage in terms of causing bankruptcy for firms or causing more longer term unemployment, etc. So fiscal policy is actually extremely important right now. And when we look at the actual fiscal response, particularly the budgetary fiscal response, for the kind of lockdown and for the kind of growth impact, the policy support has been also the least. Which I think will have some medium-term implications, but clearly these are some of the reasons why there are divergence. And I think, you know, for investors, clearly it sort of throws up winners and losers in the process.
Yeah, but, you know, I want to sort of bring it closer to in our neighborhood, you know, places like Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka. Their fiscal response hasn't been as aggressive. So while I understand that, you know, comparing ourselves with DMs, you know, places like Japan, Germany and US, you know, our response has been weak. But, you know, in our neighborhood, you know, despite not much of a fiscal and monetary stimulus, you know, those countries, at least at this point in time, the consensus forecast is that they're going to do all right. And they're going to do the drawdown in growth in India. Even a median forecast, you know, seem to suggest is one of the highest in the world, you know. So in a sense, what are we, I mean, my prior, Sonal, was until about a few months ago that, you know, we are predominantly a sort of a rural economy and where, you know, a lot of these lockdowns perhaps did not percolate down to the extent that it was sort of playing out in, you know, Bombay, Delhi. We are also have large agricultural economy. We've also discussed about, you know, sectors like BFSI, you know, which are not necessarily affected because of, or the tech industry also, not necessarily affected because of lockdown. Now, so two questions here. One, of course, is that why, and I still don't have an answer, and I do ask this, you know, question from everyone, that why India's sort of growth drawdown is significantly worse than not just the East Asian countries, you know, who perhaps you could explain by way of, you know, that their ability to tame virus was far better. Why is it worse than even South Asian countries, like what do you call people in our neighborhood? That's one. Second, of course, the question is that are analysts being therefore too pessimistic? You know, you've seen people, you know, at 9, 10, 11% growth drawdown. I mean, I cannot understand those numbers. So are analysts, economists being too pessimistic, you know, too concurrently thinking of world around them and therefore are predicting such kind of drawdowns, which would not even perhaps happen in, you know, countries like Italy or US, you know, where they are far more severely affected?
Yeah. No, that's a very good question. And I mean, Manish, we don't even have the second, you know, the April to June quarter GDP. So at this stage, what the real growth drawdown is anybody's guess. I mean, the first hang of that we will get on 31st August when we get the growth print. So, I mean, to you, the second question that you posed in terms of are analysts being too pessimistic with double digit kind of growth decline for this financial year, I think the answer is potentially yes. Because even in this April to June quarter, where we know that, you know, there's been a big hit to various kind of supply side indicators, the agriculture sector will be a positive. The financial services sector will still have a positive growth. Government spending did increase in this particular quarter. So there are some positive offsets as well. For example, I'm just talking about the April to June quarter. So our own estimate for financial year 21 is a growth drawdown of slightly over 6%. So we are not in the double digit growth decline camp. But, you know, the point is, let's look at the number. I think right now, you know, we don't have anything to benchmark ourselves to. But to your former question of why is the growth impact quite significant, I think the stringency of the policy response is important in the sense that will there be a medium-term growth damage? But the actual hit, it doesn't matter what your policy response is. If you have very stringent lockdown, activity will take a hit. So I think the reason for India seeing a bigger impact is A, the stringency of the lockdowns was amongst the highest in the world. And two, while you're right that we are sort of rural economy, but that's true. So the employment aspect, like, you know, if rural agriculture employs over 50%, but in terms of the contribution to, you know, your GDP, we are actually a services driven economy. And for, you know, for something like COVID-19, which has everything to do with contact intensive services, countries which have a higher share of services tend to be quite hit. So I would think those actually explain why there is a bigger impact also on India.
Just to sort of, I'm a bit dragging on this, but I still have it in my mind that, you know, country like Thailand, you know, which is so dominantly a tourism country, or Spain, you know, even their numbers, you know, I mean, of course, you could argue that, you know, Thailand did manage COVID-19 outbreak better. But, you know, the fact of the matter is that, you know, the tourism is down 90-95% even today. And yet, you know, the numbers coming out of those territories are not so bad versus, of course, predicted numbers of the analysts, you know. So, I mean, I don't know. You're right that, you know, let's wait when the numbers come out. Perhaps they'll not be as bad. But, you know, whenever I discuss this with Sonal, you know, people are still telling me that all these mobility indices, the stuff that they're sort of regularly tracking, they're still in India, what do you call, are underwhelming vis-a-vis, not just the emerging markets, but also developed markets. And my rant to them is, of course, is that, you know, don't track Bombay Delhi mobility indices, you know, because India lives in, you know, villages and small cities, and their activity, I think, has come back, pretty fast. So I am also worried of hysteresis. I'm also worried of some second round impact. I think in our public policy response has been weak. But I think we are, as an analyst community, exaggerating the losses, you know, and I think you sort of seem to agree with that.
I would agree with you, Manish. And in fact, it's not true that mobility data is the worst in India. In fact, Philippines is still at 45% roughly, whereas India has sort of gone to 70%. And Philippines already released its June quarter GDP. And it was, I think, down about -16%. Yeah, you're right. I think even for, you know, April to June quarter, I would agree with you. I think there are certain offsets. It's, I mean, our view is it's unlikely to be -20% or thereabouts. It's going to be a lot lesser than that.
So maybe let's spend a few minutes on understanding, Sonal, on, you know, what is the form of recovery beyond this one or two quarters? And, you know, this argument within my team also we've had, and of course there are divergent views. You know, I have, of course, believed in a V-shaped recovery from the point of view that, you know, by 2024-25, the effect of COVID would have disappeared. In a sense, we would have gone back to the old trajectory. Okay. I mean, I believed even 6 months ago that, you know, India's, you know, growth is likely to be closer to 6% over a decade. And I would imagine that, you know, that we would have gone back to that level. What are your views on it? You know, do you think that, you know, we can go back to our old trajectory of output versus, you know, a lot of people seem to believe that, you know, that these are permanent, durable losses. And, you know, while, you know, the growth rate will come back, but the level of output will never go back to the levels that we would have had without COVID.
The level of output will, of course, go back to the, you know, where we were pre-pandemic. It's just question is, you know, how long does it take? And I mean, our broad sense is, I mean, early calendar year 2022 or, you know, maybe end 2021 calendar year is when the level will reach there. And we know that FY22, because of base itself, is going to see a big jump. So I think let's focus on, let's say, the next 5 year on average, what the growth will be beyond FY22. I mean, our bias, Manish, is that the decline in trend growth we have seen, and this is something, of course, we've seen not just in India, but across a lot of emerging markets, potential growth has been declining for the last 5-8 years, which is also true in India. I mean, our view is that trend growth over the next 5 years is likely to be lower. And I think there are both global and domestic reasons for that. I mean, domestically, because, you know, the balance sheet shock that COVID has inflicted, whether it's, you know, households. So one trend that we've seen, you know, globally, when you have these kind of pandemics, is precautionary savings do tend to go up. So beyond the pent-up consumption demand, consumption trends do tend to be weaker because there is uncertainty on the, you know, job market and income prospects. We know that the banking balance sheet, the entire restructuring process will play out only over the next 2-3 years. We know what's going to happen with the corporate capex cycle, given the focus is a lot more on deleveraging. So I think both in terms of the employment generation capacity and the investment generation capacity, whether it's from the private sector or from the government side, you know, the balance sheets, I think, are quite constrained in India. And therefore, the risk of trend growth continuing to go down is there. From a global perspective, one thing that COVID has triggered is for all countries, and, you know, this is whether it's the US, China, India, Indonesia, everybody is making my country. And if the world as a whole is going to move towards more deglobalization, while you could get productivity gains because of, you know, more digitization, etc., that doesn't necessarily mean higher potential growth. So I mentioned right at the start that, you know, when we are sort of looking at the framework for how activity will play out, there's the three-phased activity that plays out before a vaccine. You get a vaccine and, you know, the activity which has, let's say, normalized at a low level goes higher. Obviously, there's a catch-up that happens. And then you get into the next phase, which is where the medium-term trend growth, a function of domestic policies, global factors, etc., mixes together and determines where potential growth will be. So I think actually it's going to be a challenge in terms of a medium-term growth prospects.
So there is, of course, this dominant view that we've had this growth potential itself secularly coming off. Post-GFC world, of course, has had sustained lowish growth pretty much across the world despite huge amount of policy support. But I want to sort of test an alternate hypothesis, you know, that, and tell me whether it is completely outrageous or it's worth thinking about. In a sense, I am a student of history, and when I think of things like post-Spanish flu, how sort of demand recovered quickly. And then, though there was a huge amount of devastation then, and more so in 40s, you know, after the World War II, people did argue that, you know, you would have another depression in the world. But because of the huge amount of fiscal response, you know, pretty much across the world, you know, relevant world, I would say, you know, India was, and many Chinese economies were not relevant. It paved way for a humongous expansion, you know, over next many decades. So given that, Sonal, you know, it is a fact of the matter that, you know, I mean, all policymakers are Keynesians now. You know, you have a size of stimulus which is unprecedented. Both sides, you know, the liberal as well as the conservatives are of the view that, you know, countries of the fiscal support has to be in place, okay, for labor as well as businesses. So $9-10 trillion of fiscal stimulus or support with near zero rates pretty much any place that you see. And then, you know, let's see what happens in Jackson Hole. But, you know, a possibility of a near zero or negative real rates for whole of 20s. Do you think that an alternate hypothesis is worth thinking of, that it could pave way for a reset and a renewed expansion in the world relative to what we have seen post-GFC?
Yeah. So Manish, I think, you know, the historical example that you're giving, clearly we need to differentiate between the after effects of a war versus the after effects of a pandemic. So you're exactly right that, you know, post-war, because there is a lot of reconstruction activity that in turn triggers, higher growth globally. But we are not in the war scenario. And in fact, in a post-pandemic world without a war, actually you do see, as I was mentioning earlier, more cautious behavior, particularly from consumers. So I would just say that we need to differentiate between those two outcomes. The second aspect is, I mean, you're right that a lot of, it's actually unprecedented, right? The kind of policy support we have seen. But this is akin to policymakers just filling in a big hole. I would not even label it a stimulus. I mean, you know, I've lost my job. The government has filled in 50% of the income I have lost. It's not going to cause me to, you know, massively increase my final demand. And that's also true for companies who are burning cash right now to stay alive, because your revenue stream is hit, whereas you have fixed costs that you have to still cater to. So the fiscal announcements that have been done so far are not stimulus. It's filling in the hole. And I think it is quite interesting, you know, last night you had in the US, American Airlines saying that if the stimulus is not extended, they will fire 19,000 workers. So that's telling you that more policy support is necessary till we are in a COVID-19 world. Once we are out of COVID-19, because the balance sheets of the private sector will be in a lot weaker shape, at that point in time, we will actually need even more policy support in order to push the growth engine going forward. So there will actually be a need for a lot more fiscal support going forward. Now, I think, you know, one very interesting, I guess, you know, toolkit that a lot of central banks will have to look into is a more coordinated monetary policy, fiscal policy going forward. Because if governments are if the government needs to provide more fiscal stimulus and issuances keep increasing, whereas interest rates, like you rightly said, are at low and will stay at a low level for quite some period of time, the central banks will need to actively actually manage bond yields, whether they do it in the secondary market or as Indonesia is doing in the primary market. But a more coordinated fiscal monetary policy is likely. Now, whether that is going to lead to faster growth, which is, you know, the point that you were asking, I think is possible. There's actually an example in Canada where the Bank of Canada actually bought government bonds in the primary market, and government used that money for productive infrastructure spending. Yes. And that did lead to no inflation and huge increases in growth and productivity in Canada. So it is possible that we get into that environment of faster growth, Manish, but there are a lot of bridges to cross to get there. And at this stage, we are not there.
So I agree that, you know, I mean, I am making a lot of assumptions, I must say, you know, but I would presume that, and rather I would, why would I presume that all of that, your ask of, you know, more fiscal response would not come if policymakers have been so committed? I'll give you two or three examples, and, you know, I want your answers, you know, because I often hear even from Indian policymakers why they're reluctant for a fiscal response is because they're worried of precautionary savings. You know, two or three things here. One is that I don't know whether you're watching, but pretty much across the world, there is a newfound boom in the real estate that, you know, home buying is actually perking up pretty much everywhere, perhaps due to low interest rates. Or perhaps because of the COVID, you know, people think that, you know, it's sort of, you know, it makes sense to buy homes in suburban areas and so on and so forth. That's already playing out in developed countries. And my bet is that something similar would happen to even our country. Two, of course, you know, is an equity market. You know, I mean, look at what they've done, you know, pretty much developed countries, you know, particularly US is up now from pre-COVID levels. But, you know, even the EMs outside of LATAMs have done really well. Third, actually, is the most interesting one is the consumer confidence index. You know, I mean, India, of course, you know, one would be really disappointing as seeing what happened to consumer, but that's not happening in the developed world. It has fallen, but it's nowhere close to what it was post-GFC, you know, when it did fall dramatically. And the fourth point, Sonal, is that, you know, it is true that, you know, some people are worried of their jobs. But then, you know, look at the wonderland that we live in, that a median US labor who has been fired is today earning more than what he was earning when he had a job. So he gets to have his paycheck as well as gets to watch 8-9 hours of Netflix. How would his confidence ever come down? So in this, with this three or four dimensions, you know, you want to sort of contextualize why presume that, you know, a consumer would go for precautionary savings and feel depressed, instead of why, you know, he could be feeling a bit go-go about, you know, investing more in more things and consuming more and more of more things.
Yeah. I mean, that's a tough one, Manish. I think So first of all, you know, the original question that you asked, I think, you know, your question of why won't policymakers enforce policies that lead to faster growth in the medium term. One impact of COVID-19 is growing inequality, both in terms of income inequality as well as wealth inequality. Because, you know, it's the SMEs that have been hit the most. It is the smaller, you know, the informal sector workers that have been hit the most. So, yes, policymakers will have to announce more stimulus. But the question is, what is the form that stimulus is going to take? Are we going to divert money to more, you know, return enhancing infrastructure projects, or are we going to use the limited money that we have in income transfers? Because, you know, ultimately, whether we have a durable growth or not is a function of what we invest in. And I think the kind of political, you know, commitments we are seeing, you know, both in EMs as well as in developed economies does seem to suggest that income inequality is a big issue politically, and a lot of the fiscal partly will be used for more productive infrastructure and partly will also be used for more income distribution kind of schemes, which are important, but in terms of multiplier effects, I'm not sure will be there. And you're right that, you know, an average US you know, household might be earning more, but that's again a function of the policy stimulus. How long are we talking about this stimulus continuing? So, see, ultimately, I think we need durable income stream. Nobody durably consumes from a transitory increase in income. Because, you know, one effect of lower interest rates and easy liquidity, and one of the transmission channels that I guess central banks are trying to achieve, is to push everybody towards, you know, buying, you know, you're reflating basically, you know, parts of the financial economy, you know, whether it's the real estate or equity market. And the assumption is that this will feed back into the real economy. I think whether it feeds back into the real economy or not is a function of whether there's a durable increase in income. I don't think transitory increase in income because of, you know, fiscal one-off transfer can lead to asset price gains, but I don't think it's going to lead to a durable growth. I think we are entering a world of growing inequality. I mean, I think one needs, it's more nuanced, I guess, in terms of the who will gain from these kind of easy policies.
So, I mean, we're fine with it. As long as there are asset price gains, you know, we have an answer. Because yeah, this is what all of us are sort of looking to inquire as to what happens to the asset prices. Okay, now I think, you know, let's dial to something which is more important for bonds. So far we've discussed the cyclical and the perhaps the medium-term growth outlook for the country and rest of the world. You know, do you get worried that it's so much of money printing and backed by huge amount of fiscal, don't call it stimulus, it's just filling the holes, but do you get worried that it could perhaps result in something that we haven't seen in the world for 40 years? And you know, do you bother that, you know, something, what happened in India in early 2010s would return, the genie of inflation would be back? How worried are you on inflation? Can it return faster than what most policymakers seem to think of?
Yeah. I think, Manish, we need to have, like, let's say, a 12 to 18 month view. And, you know, let's say view after, you know, beyond 18 months on inflation. Let's say over the next 1.5 years, I don't think money printing leads to inflation. I mean, we did see a lot of money printing even during global financial crisis. Ultimately, this needs to translate into intermediation and therefore credit growth picking up, which I don't think we are seeing globally. We are not seeing that in India. So yes, this excess money can go back to the Reserve Bank and live as excess reserves. that does not lead to credit, does not lead to demand, does not lead to inflation. Even in India, I think, you know, the if you look at the components that are driving inflation right now, seem to be largely either there is statistical abnormality or there are supply side issues on food. Taxes have gone up, specific global commodities have gone up. So it's more supply side we have seen. Prognosis on the sequential, as globally we enter phase three of this activity where sequentially growth actually tapers off, I think we will still be in a world where the output gap is negative. I would not worry about inflation, particularly demand side inflation in the next 1.5 years. There could be some supply side inflation. I mean, if you do see a very weak dollar, which feeds into you know, global commodities, but that's likely to be more transitory, because if you hit a consumer who's already burdened with the lower income, with higher prices, there will be knock-on effect on the consumer's consumption of other items. But I think, yes, one needs to think hard about what happens, let's say, beyond the next 1.5-2 years. And I think particularly if we move to a phase where we do see a more coordinated fiscal monetary easing, the easy policies, particularly easy fiscal policies that lead to more direct cash transfers continue, even while underlying economy has healed, then there is a risk that it actually leads to higher propensity to consume, final demand, and therefore maybe some inflationary pressures kicking in. So I won't say it's an immediate issue. It's more of a medium-term issue and a precursor to assess whether we are getting into that environment or not will be the kind of policy response, particularly I think fiscal combined with monetary response that we might see going forward.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, again, sort of discussing inflation a little further, that do you believe, I mean, I know that you put out a 50 basis point cut in your forecast in India as well, an additional 50 basis point cut. And I want to sort of ask you here that, you know, of course, we all understand that, you know, growth is underwhelming and it needs policy support. You also made a point that, you know, some of the inflation in India, you know, given that it's printed above 6% for now 6-7 months, some of it is transitory. And with good crop, you know, most probably it is likely that some of this, at least the food inflation, will fade. But, you know, purely talking of core inflation, you know, are you not surprised that despite such a big growth shock in India, in last couple of years, you know, even the core inflation has had some lower bound. It's really breached 4% on the lower side. Okay. And thereby, you know, is it possible to build a hypothesis that, you know, 4 appears to be a durable lower bound in India? And given that, you know, effective policy rate is already 3.35, okay, overnight rates are somewhere close to 3% in India. You're already a negative interest rate, which I agree that, you know, we need today. But then how do you cite more space in rate cuts? Because the dimension of, lower or negative real rate kicks in, especially given that the framework that we have now, MPC framework, you know, which has a target of, keeping inflation in 2-6. So therefore, the question is that, two questions. One is there a lower bound of inflation that, you know, it persists and we can't go below that in any case? And second is that, you know, you think there is going to be a revisiting of MPC framework in India to overcome this, or in spite of this, MPC can still go ahead and cut rates as you sort of have penned?
Right. I think we... there are lots of questions in there. I think the when we are in terms of the lower bound on inflation, if you actually look at a cross-country evidence of average inflation versus the amount of capital stock in a country, you do actually find that countries that have significantly invested over a period of time do tend to have lower inflation. So if you have not, and you're a supply constrained economy, yes, there is a lower bound. And to that extent, I think, you know, the lower bound on India's inflation, I think, reflects largely the supply constraints that are there in India. Now, on the RBI itself, and what, like you mentioned, we have a rate cut. I think we should split it into what RBI should do versus what they would do. Now, I would sort of agree with you that monetary policy has already done a lot of the hard work. And, you know, whether where the effective rates are, where liquidity is, we are already, I think, you know, close to the effective lower bound. So the incremental bang for the buck from rate reductions is actually not much. And if there are still parts of, you know, specific spreads that are very wide, I mean, if it is because of supply side pressures, then I think at some point in time, the central bank will have to step in to compress it. But if it is more credit risk related, then I don't think there's actually much that the Reserve Bank of India can do about it. So in terms of overall policy, RBI has done a lot already. There are specific issues now, particularly in terms of the term premium, which will need addressing going forward. But otherwise, there isn't much that RBI actually needs to do. But it's not about what they should do. It's always about what they would do. And I think relative to the current, you know, V-shaped pickup, so to speak, we are seeing, when India hits the phase three and sequential activity tapers off, and that's also a period where inflation is likely to moderate, we do think there'll be pressure on the Reserve Bank to continue to signal. And therefore, from that signaling perspective, yeah, we do think there'll be delivery of further easing in India. And, you know, like you mentioned, yes, the entire monetary policy framework is up for review. A lot of things are going to be reviewed under that, you know, whether the target should be 4%, whether the band should be plus minus 2, or should it change, whether India should target headline inflation, should we be targeting core inflation. You know, right now, for instance, we target like year ahead inflation. Should we have like more of an average inflation targeting rather than a point target? So there are a lot of nuances. And of course, most importantly, whether we should be targeting inflation or we should have, you know, maybe a higher weightage to some other factors like financial stability. So a lot of things will be up for review. I do think that implicitly, the shift has already happened. Right? I mean, the from targeting positive real rates, we are already targeting lower, you know, we are actually not targeting any real rates anymore. We've delivered all cuts despite inflation being quite high. So that tells you that the weightage on growth and financial stability has already gone higher. So implicit changes have happened. Explicitly, it'll be very difficult for India to raise the inflation target. I mean, countries are struggling to meet the target on the lower side. If India goes out there and says, okay, I'm going to increase my target from 4% to 5%, I think that'll be quite difficult. So so there will be a lot of shifts in terms of maybe the bands, what we target, etc. But I think the explicit target might stay around 4%, although the tolerance might increase implicitly.
And the related question with monetary policy, Sonal, is ideas on MMT, and what are your thoughts about it? Of course, you know, for the audience, also explain this whole idea of MMT and you know, which are the countries where this deficit financing is beginning to already happen? And you think a similar narrative could play out in India as well? Because as I see it as a bond market participant, you know, the ability for the bonds to rally irrespective of policy rate, is limited now, because all of us are extremely concerned about not just this year's borrowing, but you know, we seem, all of us are overwhelmed with the potential public debt crisis that we would potentially face in FY22 and 23 as well. It is very, very unlikely that you know, the fiscal deficit would come down to pre-COVID level for a long, long time. And there is almost a consensus amongst policymakers in the world that, you know, we need to backstop the economy by fiscal stimulus. So in that situation, you know, what is the reading? Is there a way that RBI comes forward to monetize local debt to ensure that you have a better transmission of policies? Or you think today, in today's context, people in Main Street or FM office, you know, are still averse to an idea like deficit financing?
Yeah, yeah. So MMT, of course, you know, I'm sure everybody is familiar with the modern monetary theory. I mean, the essence of it is that the central government directly issues the bond to the central bank. So the bonds never hit the secondary market. It's a direct private placement arrangement between the central bank and the government. This is something that actually used to happen historically in a number of countries. But post the 1970s, huge stagflation and change in sort of, you know, monetary policy frameworks, a lot of countries adopted flexible inflation targeting and moved to, you know, prevent central bank governments from directly placing bonds. So, you know, there was this entire renaissance of more independent central bank, delinking, etc. So, you know, we've come through that period of high inflation, lack of credibility of central bank, high inflation expectations, which led to changes globally. And this is where we are right now. One country that has experimented with, you know, MMT debt monetization is Indonesia this year. Given COVID-19, they have announced a burden sharing agreement where the government is directly placing bonds with Bank Indonesia. Investors were initially very skeptical and authorities had to convince investors that this was one-off and this would not a, you know, lead to opening of a Pandora's box where, you know, year after year, the central bank is funding the government. Because if that happens, then it can lead to, of course, excess money supply creation. Central bank loses credibility. In the extreme cases, it leads to hyperinflation. You know, we've seen such examples lead to excess currency depreciation. So there's always the restraint on not going down this route, which is considered a taboo. Now, for India as well, as per FRBM, the Reserve Bank is allowed to buy bonds in the primary market, except for when the escape clause is triggered, which, you know, one of the three conditions that triggers the escape clause is for GDP growth to be less than 3 percentage points in the previous 4 quarters on average. So when we get the next GDP print next Monday, this clause actually will likely get triggered. So from a legal perspective, RBI actually could be in a position to directly finance 0.5% of GDP. But I don't think legal restrictions are the only reason why central banks and governments don't do it. It's actually more about, you know, perception, credibility, etc. So, I mean, our view is Reserve Bank might do up to 0.5% of GDP. But I think going forward, it's more likely to be via the secondary market route, Manish, rather than the primary market route. And in the last 6 months or so, a lot of the liquidity injection in India has been through the FX intervention route, creating domestic liquidity. And therefore, in fact, the need for doing open market operations from a liquidity perspective was never there. Now, going forward, you know, as the current account moves from a surplus to a slight deficit, we see, let's say, the seasonal increase in currency in circulation, etc. It's possible, and I think particularly because we are reaching the limits on the effective lower bound in India, and you know, India has actually one of the steepest yield curve and one of the highest public debt to GDP ratio. So a lot of factors that we look at, which indicate whether a country will do debt monetization, are flashing green for India. So there is some probability of a debt monetization, but I think more importantly, because we are running out of conventional policy space, the next step for India is more around the unconventional routes. And one of those tools is a more coordinated fiscal monetary policy. And I think the secondary market, more aggressive RBI intervention, although we have not seen that really right now, but I think that's the direction in which India is also moving.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so in this, maybe you know, spend a couple of minutes on asset markets and, you know, which is where eventually that's the goal seek for us. I mean, it is deluge of dollar and of course, you know, every day 7-8 lakh crores of excess money in the system, even in India. You know, what does it do to currencies? What are your views on asset prices? You know, where are you investing your money outside of our funds?
Sure, Manish. And, you know, I would love to hear your views as well. And, you know, hopefully you're going to counter me on all those views. So I think, you know, if one leaves aside, let's say, a very, you know, tactical short-term view and bring in some of the more medium-term drivers of growth, I think from a macro perspective, we are looking at an environment where inflation, I think, still stays quite subdued. Growth beyond the initial pickup, there are challenges in terms of a durable growth revival. There are huge balance sheet challenges. And globally, we are looking at an environment where central banks are moving towards even more lower for longer. You know, Fed is talking about average inflation targeting. They might link their asset purchase program to attaining their inflation and employment objectives. So globally, monetary policies are likely to stay accommodative for a long period of time. Globally, fiscal policies will need to support growth for a long period of time. And therefore, monetary policies will need to ensure that fiscal policies do not lead to monetary conditions tightening via an increase in bond yield. So that's sort of the backdrop in which we are making our investment decision. So I think from the currency standpoint, of course, you know, dollar has weakened quite substantially. So you know, near term, of course, one needs to be a bit alert. But otherwise, the kind of twin deficit situation that US is getting into does seem to suggest a more medium term move towards a weaker dollar, which for emerging markets could actually mean more capital inflows as the hunt for yield continues. The question is whether central banks will allow the currency to appreciate or not, because when demand is already quite weak, you don't also want currency to become a big headwind to growth. So I think the view on the currency is a more a function of how central bank manages currencies. At this stage, I think the view is more towards a weaker dollar, which means the bias should be towards you know, appreciation, but I think central banks may prevent very aggressive appreciation. So let me put that as sort of the currency view. I do think that given the lower for longer global monetary policies, the kind of term premium we have in India actually makes, you know, a case for more debt investments and particularly longer term debt investments in India. Because when we talk about policy transmission, you know, and there are various ways transmission happens, money market, bond market, you know, corporate bond, bank lending channel, exchange rate channel, et cetera. I do think that the government bond yields play quite a critical role in signaling transmission. And the kind of steepness we are seeing right now does undo some of the transmission we have seen so far. So, and you know, what I mentioned earlier in terms of the unconventional policy, we are, I think, moving in a direction of more coordinated monetary fiscal policies. So I think the longer duration, to my mind, actually makes a lot of sense from an investment case. Equity, I mean, you know, I'm no expert, Manish. I'll leave it to you. I do see medium-term growth challenges. I think this is an environment where there will be a lot of winners versus losers. It's an environment of haves versus have-nots. So, you know, if you're strong balance sheet, the strong will continue to get stronger. So one needs to be extremely careful about where you put your money in this environment. But I guess as far as the discount factor is concerned, that should stay low. True. But I would love to hear your views as well, Manish.
No, our views are sort of well known to most of these participants. You know, my view since end March, Sonal, has been that we should get ourselves up for a very, very strong response from both monetary policy authorities and fiscal authorities. I think for a very, very long time, we'll have financial repression, which essentially means that fixed income, not just in India, but across the world, would earn zero or negative returns, negative real returns, I mean. And I agree that the growth drawdown is significant this year, but I've been of the view that at least the history suggests that the pandemics don't hurt economies durably. So things do tend to go back to the pre-pandemic levels. You know, we saw in 30s and then 58 and 1968, you know, so all three big pandemics, you know, it did not hurt our potential, I mean, world potential growth. And, you know, we went back to the trajectory. So it is simply a postponement of growth, I would say. And while there is some sacrifice of near-term growth, you know, it's more than made up by lower real rate. And more so when, you know, central bankers are so overwhelmingly sort of, should I say, predisposed towards zero negative rates for long. I think, you know, equity perhaps is the only place, you know, you could hide yourself for earning a reasonable return. You know, I think because the mechanics of, you know, reviving the economy itself is, you know, depressing the returns for the fixed income. So that is my overarching big picture view. I agree with you on the currency. You know, I've been sort of quite constructive on INR and other emerging market currencies. I think they will over next couple of years, you know, continue to stay stable, or and the path of least resistance for some of them could be actually appreciation, again for the reasons that you mentioned. I mean, I have a few questions here from audience, Sonal, and you know, let's say Soumya is asking, how long do you think this asset inflation across the board will last, since the market is always ahead, and how much has been priced in? Do you have any view on this? Do you think, you know, as Mr. Shaktikant Das also alluded to a couple of days ago, a bit of a Greenspan moment, you know, where he said that, I don't know exactly, but he sort of dismissed markets that, you know, they're being too optimistic. You know, you think similar, that markets are being too optimistic and this asset inflation is perhaps gone to the point of irrationality?
I mean, of course, you know, to be frank, I have been surprised with the kind of, you know, V-shaped recovery we have seen in asset prices. But having said that, I mean, clearly the tech sector in US, for instance, has benefited substantially from this entire COVID-19 crisis, because a lot of the companies that are actually adding to the US market cap are, of course, focused on specific sectors. And the lower for longer monetary policy in terms of discount factor plays a role. The policy stimulus in US has been quite substantial. So for a forward-looking market, perhaps it makes sense. So yes, there is a disconnect in the sense that and to be fair, I mean, real economy has also seen a pickup compared to the April lows. I think the true test, Manish, will come once we enter phase three of this cycle, where sequentially there is a bit of a slowdown. And post that, in terms of whether there is indeed long-term damage or not, I mean, so that will truly determine. But I think in which case there could be frictions, going forward. So one needs to, of course, not again linearly extrapolate from what we have seen so far. That's all I can say right now.
Another question from Jignesh Shah, an investor. He makes this point, I think, sort of a retort to original point I once made in the beginning, that those cities are affected, but maybe rural and small towns are sort of coming back. He makes this argument that economic activity in India are very concentrated in these big cities, so it's a big risk to the overall economy. I have a small point here, and I would love to hear your response. Interestingly, in India, big cities like Mumbai, Delhi, perhaps are anywhere coming close to, dare I say, herd immunity. And therefore, the outlook for the big cities look better in next few months and perhaps rest of the year than smaller towns. Would you concur with this? Purely looking at through the COVID lens, someone like Mumbai actually perhaps would be the first city in the world who would secure herd immunity.
Yeah, which is true, right? I mean, you can see it in terms of cases have clearly tapered off in Delhi. And even a lot of the states in southern India are now starting to see a plateau in cases. And I mean, you're exactly right. If you look at the second derivative in terms of new Delhi cases, there is a tapering off in the pace. So that is true at the margin, the second derivative rate of increase is coming off, one. And two, the concentration of cases is moving, like you said, from the big cities to probably the hinterlands. Let's see how it plays out. In terms of the impact on ultimately COVID-19, in India also, the fatality rate is quite late, low. The recovery rate is quite high. But ultimately, the impact on economic activity is a function of the consumer behavioral response. So it doesn't matter what COVID is. It's about how, you and I as consumers behave to the perception of COVID being a risk. And so long as we do not go back to our original activity, I think the impact will still be there. So I think we need to look at COVID, but also the consumer behavior to COVID. And right now we are seeing cases drop in cities, but in terms of the consumer behavior, it also needs to show a sustainable normalization in activity, which at this stage, I would say the evidence is quite mixed.
Okay, I have another question from Chandrasekhar Dixit. He says that is the current rise, perhaps he alludes to equity, due to Fed pumping money in USA market till November election. I would love to hear your thoughts on, world should bother about asset markets, or otherwise should bother about, what's the outcome from US elections? And do you have a bet on who's going to win?
Ultimately, I think the economy is what we need to focus on. I mean, obviously, elections are important, but I think the economic trajectory and policies broadly will determine asset prices rather than the election outcome per se. Currently, of course, Biden is leading. It will have an impact in terms of the kind of policies he adopts. So, our own sense is there is, of course, bipartisan support in the US now with respect to China. Yes. But when it comes to trade policy issues, the Biden administration, instead of taking a more bilateral approach as President Trump has done, under a Biden administration, it might be more multilateral. What that implies is that trade policy uncertainty that we have seen in the last 4 years could be lower if the administration changes. But the broader move of, you know, supply chain diversification from China will continue. The Biden administration may continue to be quite hawkish on things like human rights, for instance. You know, he's quite focused on income inequality as an issue. You know, they do see globalization as a threat and one of the reasons for widening income inequality in US. So, you know, US is also focusing on Make in America products. So, you know, protectionism is also going up in the US. So I think it'll have some important implications across sectors. You know, for instance, he has specific policies around tech monopolies, financial sector. He wants to tax the rich, tax the wealthy, corporate tax rates might go up, tax rates on higher income individuals will go up. So I think there will be relative shifts, but in terms of broader asset prices, I mean, you could argue that if, you know, taxes go up, it's not necessarily good. For instance, corporate taxes go up. But at the end of the day, I think we should focus on the economy and policy changes will drive the relative shifts, I would think.
True. So I don't know whether you sort of heard him talk about FDR and potentially a new deal of sorts. I think a couple of days back, a Democratic convention, he made that. He alluded to something similar to what was done in the US post-World War II. And at least my views is that, it is possible that Biden, from a pure spending standpoint, I think will have less constraints, you know, ideologically, given that Democrats are somewhat predisposed towards more public spending and infra spending. Though I agree with you that on the taxes side, you know, he's been very hawkish in the past, and but it's very, very difficult to unwind what Trump has done. But a small point here, I want to ask you that, you know, who is good for India, though? I mean, I've heard him being somewhat critical of the current administration. You think Trump is better for India, I mean, vis-a-vis Biden, or it sort of doesn't matter? You know, Mr. Modi can build friendship with anyone and everyone.
Honestly, I think it's really hard to say right now. From a foreign policy perspective, one needs to see. I mean, our own sense is, with respect to the broader foreign policy agenda of, let's say, a Biden administration, it'll largely be similar to the Trump administration. So, Asian countries in general will be left to fend for themselves in terms of balancing US versus China. So I don't think from India's perspective, you know, US being or showing the leadership role and cause resulting in more geopolitical stability in the region is going to change under a Biden administration. Perhaps on visa related immigration issues, he could be a bit softer. On trade policy issues, he could actually be a bit softer. So I'm not sure one can necessarily characterize based on certain statements that it's negative. I think it's quite mixed overall, to be honest.
I agree. I think, you know, there is a bit of a geopolitical reset, Sonal, and I don't know whether you agree with this, but I think it's a little bit of an anti-China camp, and, you know, I think, you know, the West would perhaps, there'll be a reasonable correlation with India and Australia and, you know, some of these countries. And I think at margin, you know, I think our relationship with the US would actually get better irrespective of who the president is. I have, you know, two questions, and perhaps these are the last questions, we've overshot our time. One is from Sriram. He makes this point, and a very good one, that is it too early to think about the risk of exits from unorthodox policy response? The scale and size is so huge, and exits are going to be material risk as they happen unless we have sizable inflation back. You know, he wants to hear your thoughts on this.
Absolutely. I mean, I completely agree with that. I think we are still in the very early phases of just normalization. We haven't even found a vaccine. We don't know what the longer term effects of COVID-19 are going to be. So yeah, absolutely agree. I think it's too early to be talking about an exit.
And you, would you buy gold as a defense to, this super aggressive monetary policy and fiscal policy in the world? And a fear of inflation would push you towards, buying gold or other metals?
Yeah, I think so. Because if you're getting into a world of lower and lower, real interest rates, and if you do see also a weaker dollar kind of a regime because of the kind of balance sheet expansion we have seen and what we will probably continue to see, yes, I would think that, gold and other metals should do well.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this is okay. I know we're overshooting, but I have last question here. And, I think of the world as, especially, what's happening between US and China is actually a tech war. And far too many people presume that US would win this. And if I were to place odds, I would say it's 60-40 in favor of China. Do you have some thoughts on it? Because I think, the one who would dominate the world and the new world order, so to say, would be the one who would actually be ahead in some of these frontier technologies. And China seems to be ahead in most of these technologies. So do you have some thoughts on it? And would you have some suggestions for the policymakers, at least in India, who seem to be sort of straying away from this and, away from China, so to say, and, given that China is a neighborhood and is going to be perhaps a leader in tech, we better be friends with them, So on these two, do you have some thoughts?
So on the tech side, Manish, I think in terms of where China is on the tech value addition, over the last two decades, China has moved up the manufacturing value chain. Of course, US, is accusing that has happened because of the, infringement on intellectual property rights, etc. But while China has moved up the value chain, Manish, I don't think on the tech side, they have reached the level where they can sustain themselves. Mm-hmm. Because if they do not get, the inputs from US tech companies, they will need to do a lot of indigenous tech development, which they have been working on. But our sense is they are not there yet. And therefore, some of the targets that they have set for themselves in terms of this Make in China 2025 strategy do come under threat because of this more isolationist policies, or rather more isolation that China is finding itself. So in terms of China winning the tech war, I don't think China is there yet. I think US is actually making it a lot more difficult for China to climb up the tech value chain. Mm-hmm. On India and neighbors with China, I think ultimately the global village is shrinking. I think for India, we need to maximize our opportunity. We have a great pull factor in terms of a big consumer market. The two opportunities are clearly low cost of capital, a lot of liquidity being pumped, etc., looking for higher return investments. And you have the global value chain shifts that are ongoing. Our focus should be on how do we maximize from the opportunity set that we have, rather than, go towards policies that are akin to, hurting our own self. So we need to be conscious of that and try to maximize from these opportunities that are there in this sort of, world economy today.
So what do I tell my kids? I mean, they're young and, if they have to sort of look through these where the bond yield will be tomorrow and day after. What do I tell them? Is there a place for India to, I often give them this spin that, India was, of course, once upon a time a very, very big country, you know, in those days, you know, frontier in terms of tech world. And then, you know, we've sort of lost out in last few centuries. You think, you know, is there a positive spin that a story that I can give to them that 20, 30, 40 years out, you know, in the clash of titans, one civilization which is there is actually that of Indic civilization, or it's just the Anglo-Saxons versus the Chinese?
I would not lose hope.
Very big picture,
I would definitely not lose hope. And I'm hopeful. Ultimately, nothing is destiny. You want to achieve something, you need to put policies in place. There are challenges in the short term and the medium term, but I think we know what we need to do to get there. We need to see those things getting implemented. So nothing is destiny. I mean, you know, I would be more positive and hopeful, from a longer term perspective.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much on this optimistic note. You know, it's difficult to get economists, the dismal scientists, you know, being optimistic, but, you know, sort of, okay, Sonal, thank you very much. Thanks for tuning in and, you know, answering our questions. And to the audience, I hope it was useful. Thanks, Sonal, again. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Yeah.